So today is really going to be about making sure that you can understand whether or not you might be a good fit for the program. So I'm going to really start at the beginning today. So I work for the National Science Foundation. That's the agency that runs this program. The goal of our program is really to help bring new groundbreaking technology from the lab into the market, which means the creation of new products and services that are based on new discoveries, that are based on new innovations in science and engineering. And the way that we do this here is that we provide grants or cooperative agreements to fund research and development at small businesses. The funding that we provide is non-dilutive. We do not take a piece of your cap table. We do not take a board seat. It is not a loan. You do not have to pay it back. So we run this program at significant scale. To give you all a sense, I'll talk about the exact phases later, but our awards come in chunks of roughly $250,000 to $1 million. We fund over $200 million across our portfolio each year. That adds up to about 400 awards to about 400 different businesses across the country each year. At any given time, there are about 700 small businesses and startups that are actively working and being supported by NSF that are in our portfolio. This is a phased program. The funding that is given by us is dispersed over typically a year or 2 years, and the phases are sequential. And so the whole process here could last up to about 5 years if you go through all the phases of funding that we have available. And if you do that, you have the opportunity to get about up to $2 million of non-dilutive funding to do R&D to build out your new product or your new service. So the first thing I want to point out is that we do look for this new unproven technology, and we look for it across the board of technology areas. We do not have a favored technology area or a favored market area. We really try to support startups and small businesses working in any area of technology or of the market where we see the kind of technical innovation and technical risk that we're looking for, and where we see a strong commercial case based on the development of that technology. So you can see on this slide kind of a very diverse portfolio across lots of different areas of technology. You will also notice that some of these areas have significant overlap with the areas funded by other federal agencies, many of whom also have SBIR programs. So even though if you're a medical company, you may think that the National Institutes of Health is the fit for your company, but you should understand that the NSF supports projects that overlap with a lot of other agencies' areas of interest. There's really no technology area we don't support, as long as we see the other characteristics of the types of companies we want to fund. The only thing that we don't support as kind of a rule is that we do not support clinical trials for new pharmaceutical drugs, things that are actually randomized controlled trials of new medical interventions, are things that we typically don't support. Although we do have a pharmaceutical technologies topic, and we do fund a lot of preclinical and research and development related to new pharmaceutical and new medical interventions. I have a couple slides here about the demographics of our companies. One thing may be really important for all of you. Many of you are first-time applicants. That's great. Most of the awards that we make in our first phase of funding are to companies that are applying for the first time. And so we don't require you to be a veteran proposal writer or a government funding expert. We do require you to go through our process and to, really be honest and forthright about what you're trying to do, and to convince us that there's a really strong impact commercially that's going to have significant impact for the country. Similar than that, most of the companies we fund are quite small. The median company in phase one is 2 employees, and most of the companies we fund are less than 10 employees. Finally, most of the companies are pretty new. So most of you who are applying, most of the companies we funded this year, the majority of the companies we funded this year were not established as of the beginning of 2018. So it's not a problem to be a new startup. In fact, it's oftentimes a good thing. So a couple of things just about the scale of what we do and the outcome and the track record of our portfolio companies. We've made about 3,500 awards now since 2012. Those have gone to something like 2,500 to 2,800 different businesses. And if you're able to get funding from us, it's actually a really good sign in terms of your ability to raise follow-on capital. And almost all of our companies, to be really significantly successful, they're going to need to raise funding beyond our funding. Many times that's from the private sector, although it could be from other places. So the data we have on that shows that since 2015, we have invested and the NSF have invested about a little over $1 billion in our awards across the board for everything that we've supported. In that same time, our portfolio companies have raised $9 billion in follow-on equity financing. And so that's a really strong track record of being able to follow on our investment with private capital. Over that same period of time, our companies have had over 150 successful exits, which is to say the company came to a successful outcome by acquisition or merger with a larger company. That is typically the way that many of our companies finally transition their technology to the market at scale. This is, by the way, probably a lowball. This is data just based on public announcements, and so there's probably some exits that were not publicly stated. So I'm going to walk through, this is a really critical slide, I'm going to walk through the types of things that separate companies that are a good fit from ones that are maybe not a good fit. So one of the things NSF looks for is what we call intellectual merit, but for your point of view, what you should think about is a deep technology innovation. And as I said, this is an innovation where you've got a new way of doing things, a new way of building your product or service based on a new discovery or a new innovation, new kind of engineering technology. And the way to think about this is that it's not something where you're taking an existing technology and using it to do something new. It's not combining existing technologies in a straightforward way. It's something that is a wholly new way of doing things. It's not like anything else, and it's typically unproven, and you don't know if you're going to be able to take your approach and make it work in a product or service. So one of the best ways to think about innovation is to think about that what you're doing just doesn't, like the product or service itself just doesn't look like anything else that's on the market. The second thing we look for is high risk, technical risk, meaning that the product or service may simply not work. It may simply be impossible for you to make it work in the way that it needs to work to be a successful product or service. So this doesn't have to do with the risk of your business model or your customers. It's just making the product work. A good way to think about technical risk is to ask yourself the question, if another team of people who are versed in your area, who had the right technical background, had the same idea, would they even have a hard time making sure that they could make it work, or would it be straightforward? If it's straightforward for people who know the area, it may not be the level of risk that we need in our program. So we are trying to ask you to bring us things that are pretty far out there on the frontier of possibility. And we do understand that a lot of our projects, therefore, will fail because the technical risk will not be overcome. The next thing we look for is evidence of problem solution fit. As I mentioned, most of the companies we fund are pretty early. So you may not have a pure product market fit where you've got a huge amount of traction from customers, but we want you to have done some homework to understand enough to guess about whose problem your technology will solve, to work with those people, to talk to them and try to get some sense that if your product works the way it should, and again, we know we talked about it might not, but you assume it works the way you hope it will work, that it's going to solve these people's problem and that it's going to solve a problem that's important enough that they're going to be able to pay you for it and that you're going to be able to build a business off the revenues that you're going to be able to extract from that transaction. So really important. Most of the biggest reason our portfolio companies fail is because they don't actually have a solution that solves a problem important enough to get customers to pay them for it. They're building something that nobody really wants. The next thing we look for is we look for a strong commercial intent. Our goal is that the companies that are applying to our program are applying because this funding is going to be a stepping stone on their way to a commercially focused business. If your number one priority is building a new product and getting into the market with it, that's what we want. If your number one goal is to be able to do research because you think it's interesting and fun and you know you like it, that's great. But again, this funding that we provide should be viewed as a means to an end, and the end is for your commercialization of your technology into the market. And so we want to see that the team was really formed with this, ideally with this one thing that they're trying to do, with this one new technology, and you're going to focus on taking that technology, proving it out, and taking it to market. And you're not going to try to do lots of different technologies. You're not going to try to, you know, do contract research, that your goal is really to do some research now and then later on be a commercially focused operating company. And finally, we are open only to US-based small businesses. This is a legal eligibility requirement. The definition is at the SBA's website at sbir.gov if you want to read the rules. But basically, a small business means you have fewer than 500 employees. US-based means that your majority of your ownership and your control of your company is held by US-based individuals, which means individuals who are citizens or permanent residents in the United States. So that has to be at least 51% of your stock and 51% or more of your control of your company. You can also, in some cases, be owned by another small business, but that small business would have to also be owned by US individuals. So if you have any questions about eligibility, you're welcome to reach out, but you can also go to the sbir.gov site, and they have an eligibility guide there if you're interested in getting into the weeds of that. A few examples of some companies that we think are illustrate what we're looking for. I'm not going to talk about all of these. On the top left is a company called Ecovative Design. These guys use agricultural waste to grow a mushroom-based packaging material. They actually just last week raised $60 million from follow-on investors. And so they're basically providing an alternative to styrofoam, which is purely biodegradable and which is sourced from agricultural waste. In the lower left, Diligent Robotics. This team is bringing new robotic assistance to the medical space, to hospitals, to assist in some of the lower value tasks that doctors and nurses currently do. So basically assisting the medical care enterprise. So a lot of commercial vision and robotics technology built into that environment. The company in the middle is Unspun. This company is a company that's using computer vision and 3D manufacturing to create customized genes for consumers. You can print your own genes that are tailored to your body. And then the other three companies I won't talk about, but I will point out that all three of these got support from us to get started. And all three of them are actually now billion-dollar companies, which is great. Thousand Eyes, which is on the top right here, was actually just acquired by Cisco, who will now push your technology further into the market. Okay, let me talk briefly about the phases. Again, most of this is far in the future for all of you, but the first phase, the one you'll be thinking about now, is it's a $256,000 award. It typically gives you support for 6 to 12 months of research. And phase one is about demonstrating feasibility. Feasibility meaning that high technical risk that I talked about is something you're going to try to get rid of in phase one. You're going to try to show us that you're going to be able to overcome those technical showstoppers to be able to create the product or service you're trying to create. You may not actually get to a prototype in phase one, but you're going to try to attack the biggest risks and show us that those have been managed. Phase two will take you further towards a workable product. It's a $1 million award for 2 years, and it can mean a lot of different things in phase two, depending on the technology. But again, the idea here is research and development that is laser focused on moving your company toward the market. And then phase 2B is an opportunity for phase two awardees, which allows you to get another $500,000 based on your ability to bring in third-party revenues or investment. We match that $1 to $2 up to another $500,000. So that kind of gets you close to these three phases will get you close to the $2 million that I talked about. We have a few other supplemental opportunities in phase two that I won't talk about, but you can read about them on our website. All right, if you're interested in getting started, here's what you do. We have two stages to our process. The project pitch is the first thing that you have to do. And it is something that allows us to get a little bit of information about your project, enough to think, to give get a sense about whether we think you are maybe a good fit for the program or not. This is about a 2 to 3 page document. It's a few questions that you have to answer. It's submitted through our website. You're going to talk about the technology innovation. Again, what is the unique disruptive technical approach? What are you going to do in phase one? What are you going to use NSF funding to do in terms of the technical objectives and the challenges you're going to overcome? So trying to understand, you know, how our funding is going to push the technology forward. We want to understand the market opportunity, which should be the thing that led your company to get started. And then we want to understand a little bit about the company and the team and who we're going to be supporting. I think it goes without saying that most folks know that the startups, the most important thing is considered to be the team. And so that's something that we want to start to understand. The project pitch is something you can submit anytime. It's always open. It's through our website. You are limited to one at a time. So you want to pick the project that you think is the best fit, the most important project for your company. And after you submit it, we're expecting you to wait for a response. You could theoretically resubmit a project pitch, but ideally, you know, you would want to pick that one thing that's the most important for your company. The processing time for the project pitch is listed a month here, but the actual average time to respond to this is closer to 1 to 2 weeks. But we do turn them around continuously as they come in. And you can submit them on your website, seedfund.nsf.gov/apply. You can also go to that site and you can see the specific questions you're going to be asked about if you want to kind of start to think about them without having to actually submit the full document now. What happens after you submit your project pitch? So as I mentioned, you'll wait for up to a month, but more typically a couple of weeks. If we think you might be a good fit, you'll get an email inviting you to submit a full proposal. The email will be from a program director who is actually the person who runs the portfolio area that we think is appropriate for you. And so you'll not only not have to worry about where do you fit, but you'll also have a contact from the person who is the best person to answer any questions you have about the full proposal. So that would be, that's very helpful, we found, for folks to understand the point of contact. You'll also probably be given a fair amount of feedback by that program director about specific to your proposal, things that they think are important to focus on or to work on or that they'll be looking for. If you're not a good fit, you'll be told that you're not invited and you'll get feedback as to why. We have a few reasons we typically use to not invite. Typically, it has to do with the lack of the technical innovation and risk we're looking for, or the fact that your project is just not an R&D focused project, that you need money, but it's not for research and development. And as I mentioned, research and development is the only thing that we can pay for. Essentially, the submission window is for the full proposal, and these are like 3-month windows for the full proposal. I wouldn't worry too much about the full proposal until you get past the project pitch stage. So here's where you find that pitch, top right box here. This is the front page of our website. And with that, I am done with the prepared presentation.